Honor and privilege to introduce a discussion amongst two giants. Please welcome Jamie Ian Swiss and Richard Dawkins. Up until lunch today, we haven't really been together since last spring, and Michael Sherman was home. A lot has happened since then, and many people ask, I would be remiss if I didn't ask, how is your health, sir?
Please forgive me if I croak. Can you hear me?
Can you get him a little hotter so he doesn't have to strain his voice? It's a little weaker today.
So she went into the garden to pick a cabbage leaf to make
it. Sorry, we'll get it right. We're pretending we're in Pam, nothing works. This is dead. Pardon me, Richard, now I'm picking your pocket. It's on, he's got a green light, and his mic is dead.
So they can edit all of that out.
Back on YouTube. It's great to see you again. I think the last time we were together was at Michael Sherman's last spring. A lot has happened since then, and many people ask, and I would be remiss if I did not ask. How's your health, sir?
Please forgive me if I croak. I just had a minor stroke. Basal ganglion on the right makes me walk as if I'm tight. So if I fall to groans and croaking, Jamie, you must do the talking.
Before you made a public statement, but similar, it was very similar. You were your invariable self. You were your invariable, rational, curious self. There was nothing about how awful it was or how awful you felt. There was just, well, it's interesting. I'm looking into this, and I'm told this, and I'm not sure about that. And I'm going to see how, I want to see how the brain rewires itself. You took it as a scientist, as the inveterate curiosity seeker.
Well, the basal ganglion doesn't affect higher cognitive functions. And I'm delighted to say, and I hope I can bear that out today, but it was a bit scary. I found I couldn't use my left hand. I couldn't pick things up. Or if I could pick them up, I couldn't let them go again. I was staggering around. I couldn't stand up straight. Couldn't go downstairs. My voice started croaking, and it still is, as you can hear. I found I couldn't sing, which was no great hardship. I don't need to sing for my career.
Were you much of a singer before?
I sang as a treble in the choir at school, in the chapel, sacred music. And when my voice broke, I could still sing in tune, but I wasn't any good. But now I can't even do that. I regard it as a kind of litmus test. When I can sing again, I'll see how I can be recovered.
And the limit on singing, is that being able to find pitch, or is that a physical limitation in your voice?
I think it's in the voice, yes. I can play an instrument. I can play an instrument by ear, and that's not impaired at all.
What do you play?
Well, I now play the iwi.
Nothing.
Electronic wind instrument. It's a long thing like a clarinet or a oboe. You stick it in your mouth, and the other end is a wire that goes to a computer. and you play it like an oboe or a clarinet, like that. But what comes out of the computer depends on the software. So it can sound like a clarinet or an oboe or a tuba or a trumpet or a violin or a cello, which is wonderful because...
You can't play any of those.
As you know, when you start learning to play the violin, it sounds awful.
Right.
When you play it on the iwi, it sounds wonderful. You've got this perfect sort of high-fits vibrato, and when you tongue it, you go tch, 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 you get the zing of the bow.
Oh, yes, right. Attack of the bow.
And you just play perfectly the very first time you start playing it.
Proving we could all use a little post-production. One more on this. After spending 3 years writing your memoirs, or more or less, and then sort of after that, or right after that, you have a stroke. And one way or another, did either or both together lead you to think a little more about one's mortality?
Yes, I suppose so. I mean, obviously having a stroke makes you think that. Writing autobiography, well, you look back, and I chose to write my autobiography when I did, partly because my mother was still alive and still is still alive. She's 99, she's 100 in November. So she was available for me to ask questions about my early childhood, and that was wonderful. I was led to think about mortality. I think if there's anything frightening about mortality, it's probably the idea of eternity. And eternity is something, if it's frightening, you best spend it under a general anesthetic, which is what's going to happen to all of us. So I think eternity is only really frightening if you imagine spending, actually living through eternity.
Fair enough. And the last one is, I remember it was now thinking about those early emails from you. You sent me a photo of a little piece of plastic with a bunch of holes in it, in which you had to thread an arm through.
Yes.
As a physical therapy task. And I remember you saying something about, you wrote something like, I forget, embarrassed to say what a sense of accomplishment.
I was very well treated. I had physiotherapy every day for 6 weeks. A woman came to my house for 6 weeks, all free of the National Health, by the way. And occupational therapy, I had to do this stupid threading thing.
Yes.
And I had to do it left-handed, which is the problem. I'm still a lot better with my right hand than my left hand.
But you're managing to type. I remember that was your first real frustration. I can't tweet!
I don't. No, I'm not allowed to tweet. It's bad for the blood pressure. My typing, I can still type fast, touch type, but left hand is very inaccurate, so I have to go back and correct everything with my right hand afterwards.
Oh, interesting. Not speed, but just accuracy.
Yeah.
So, completely different direction. We kind of know what the big questions are that physicists and astrophysicists are looking at: origin of the universe, the Big Bang, expanding universe. What about remaining questions in biology? What are big questions or a big question in biology that you think of?
The biggest of all, I suppose, has got to be the neurobiology of subjective consciousness, which is a deeply mysterious problem. We all have it. Presumably several other species have it as well. It must have evolved by natural selection, and said something about the brain that does it. Our most advanced computer programs, which can do things like play chess to grandmaster standards, I don't think anybody thinks they're conscious. There it is. It's a thing that brains do, and it's a thing that evolution has achieved. and it's a thing that we really don't understand.
So, and what about, and I think it's two questions related, what about art and life? I mean, we're still making attempts to recreate life in the lab, as it were, the moments that we jump,
yes,
from, I mean, we jump from one thing to another.
Once you had genes, once you had high fidelity, self-replicating molecules in the world, it's quite philosophically interesting because I expect you were all here to see Jamie's act.
There were some folks who did only came in today.
Okay, well, I mean, miracles were performed on stage. Now, we know they were not miracles, but that's only because we know that Jamie's honest and he tells us that they're not general miracles. There are frauds out there who do the same kind of tricks not so well and claim that they are miracles. They're so-called paranormal. Now, when you think about the reason why most people are religious believers, it's because of miracles. Jesus turned water into wine. The child's play for Jamie.
That old thing. The loaves and the fishes. So BC.
Yeah. I used to pay lip service to the view that it would be easy to convince me of the existence of God. It would only take some voice in the clouds to say, in a deep Paul Robeson voice, I am here, I am God. And I thought, well, obviously I would then be God. I'm not so sure. If we apply Hume's criterion, which is more likely that it's something supernatural, a miracle, or that there's some trickery, if not an earthly conjurer, some extra planetary conjurer, or that I'm hallucinating, or that I'm dreaming, or that I'm drunk, or any of those sorts of things. I find it rather hard to set out a scenario that would actually convince me that God exists. And it's partly because of conjurers that I feel that.
But we often ask believers, well, what would convince you? What would talk you out of your belief? So do we really want to be in this position of saying, there's nothing that we can
do? Well, I don't think I would talk them out of it. I mean, I just want them to admit there is no positive reason for their belief.
Right.
I suppose I'm worrying now because I've said that there could be no positive reason. I don't know. I mean, that's an idle speculation that one cannot think of something that really would convince one.
Right.
Well,
the burning bush wouldn't do it for you. Talking burning bush?
Burning bush is too easy. I do think, the sort of 900-foot Jesus descending out of the clouds, that might do it.
I guess I'll let Dr. Who.
But it does look supernatural, and I think it's a salutary lesson.
Yeah. Yes, it is a lesson. And that's actually the lesson that magicians, that's the reason magicians have been involved in critical thinking for as long as there's been a record of it. I often point to Discovery of Witchcraft, 1584, a classic Elizabethan text, which questions the evidence for witch burnings of James in England. But it doesn't say, given that it's 1584, he doesn't say there's no such thing as witches. What he does say is he questions the evidence that was being used at the time to convict witches. To me, that makes him a skeptic.
Well, it's interesting that when that homeopathy paper was published in Nature, Ben Benist,
yes,
the editor of Nature, then engaged the services of Randi and a couple of other people to go and investigate.
That's right.
So he actually chose a conjurer to go and investigate
this
claim of homeopathic.
Yeah, and at the birth of parapsychological research in the early 20th century, when the Scientific American magazine organized the committee, Harry Houdini was a member of that. And from the time of Harry Houdini to Randi and beyond, magicians are basically always said to scientists, if you're studying, especially parapsychologists, if you're studying something where deception might be involved, you need an expert on deception. All of the academic training in the world does not make you any more immune to that.
I mean, the spoon vendors notoriously fooled scientists.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. And physicists are the ones who will come up with these elaborate explanations. There were many at the time when Geller first showed up on the scene, there were many scientists who were taken in, and then or the ones who didn't believe, they came up with cockamamie explanations, is using special chemicals and heat on the hands and all of this, because the explanations of magic are often counterintuitive.